Hello. I thought I'd talk a bit about what I thought of as the subtext of Michelangelo Antonioni's film called Blow Up from 1966. I think it's at this point it's probably Antonioni's most famous movie. I mean, it was maybe a bigger cult classic when it came out, and then its star has somewhat begun to fade. In the subsequent decades, but I think it's still probably the most famous film of his, but I think it's also by far his most misunderstood film, and I don't want to do like a typical review of it. I'll just do something that's a bit more like an analysis of some of the themes that are in there. And I suppose I'm gonna have to go over the main lines of the plot, since it's probably a film that many haven't seen exactly recently. So the photographer played by David Hemmings, he's he's there, sort of walking in circles inside his little lifestyle at the beginning. He's a photographer. To pay the bills, he's doing these kinds of, silly fashion photo shoots, which he takes very seriously. As a professional, he's the kind of domineering taskmaster who has, little patience for anyone else. He just wants the job done his way. But anyway, he finds that kind of career very unsatisfying ultimately. You see, David Hemmings, he also tries to be like a more artistic photographer. So you see him take these kinds of sort of more André Cartier-Bresson-esque photographs of like workers leaving the factory, and he tries to put together a portfolio of like his artistic photographs, which he doesn't do to pay the bills, but presumably does to prove his mettle, let's say. But we also see that that is ultimately unsatisfying for him. And he's just a person who feels in typical Antonioni fashion, very alienated from the modern world. He feels profoundly lost and is just sort of aimlessly wandering, searching for something. And you see, on a plot level, the most important thing that happens in his life is when he accidentally breaks free from repeating the circle of his typical activity. So what's happening is that there's like a synthesis between his two different photographical modes. So, like, he's at a park. He's just, you know, searching for subjects to photograph. And he sees Vanessa Redgrave. And now, Vanessa Redgrave is something like a cross between a fashion model and a worker leaving the factory. So that it's sort of, it's made unclear how it is that, like he's treating her as like the best of both worlds. I suppose that's what I'm going after. So David Hemmings, he gets super excited. He starts photographing her. And you know, just something about it just touches him a bit differently. He cannot explain it, but it just sort of rejuvenates his spirits photographing her. Now, you know, him meeting Vanessa Redgrave, well, it's a gift that keeps on giving, because apparently he saw something that he wasn't supposed to see, and what's worse, he photographed something which turned into evidence that no one was supposed to have. So now Vanessa Redgrave comes and tracks down David Hemmings, and she starts bothering him about the photographs. So like this is a further break from his typical routines. Like he's used to basically his models being just objects. But now, you know, Vanessa Redgrave, she's an object that, refuses to be merely an object. So she insists on being her own sovereign presence, and it's just stirring the photographer's life that she's, you know, not just some sort of a mechanical doll, but a real person. So anyway, they go over the photographs that he sort of secretly took, and you know, he's promising to give them to her, even though he doesn't want to, because something about them just sort of made him come alive in a different way that neither his fashion photography nor his artistic photography did. So he doesn't want to give them away because they just seem somehow special to him. And so Vanessa Redgrave thinks that she got the potentially incriminating evidence from David Hemmings, and she leaves. And then David Hemmings, she gave her the wrong role of film. So he goes to develop the material that he has, and the blow up of the title would seem to point to him basically it's like he's zooming to a specific detail in a photograph, and he's, you know, making he's turning that little object in the frame into a big picture. So that's the blow up on some level. Or at its most obvious level, that's the blow up. So what is the object that David Hemmings is zeroing in on? He thinks that there's a corpse. He thinks that he witnessed a murder and that Vanessa Redgrave, that she basically killed the dude she was with. And now David Hemmings, he really found his meaningless life stirred, because this is an event that cannot just be shrugged off. It leaves him permanently stirred, that he thinks that he just spent an afternoon with a murderer, maybe. So he goes back to the, I suppose he's sort of trying to shake it off. He doesn't want to have anything to do with it, but he can't. And he tries to go back to just walking in the circles of his little routines, but he feels him so fundamentally changed that he cannot just go through the motions. So he has to go back to the park, and he sees a corpse there. And then he goes back to his apartment, he realizes that Vanessa Redgrave has been there, and the photographs that he's taken have been stolen. So, I think what happens next is that he goes back to the park and the corpse isn't there either. So now what's happening is that he starts to sort of question his own sanity. Is that, like, he thinks that there's been a murder, but, like, there's no way to prove anything. Like, there's no corpse, there's no photographs or anything. It's just something that he thinks that he witnessed. But then you see that at the beginning of the film, he's just sort of, to say that he's alienated is just to say that he doesn't have, like, an emotional connection with anything. But at the end of the film, he's like a different type of alienated. He's like, at the beginning, he simply wasn't in sympathy with his surroundings, but at the end of it, it's as if he, that he wasn't on the same wavelength, because he stopped understanding both his own wavelength and the wavelength of the world. So he was sort of, he managed to get even more profoundly alienated. But that's just the plot of the movie. Everyone could more or less tell you that. But I'm arguing that that's actually not at all the point of the movie. And I'm arguing that Antonioni is after something completely different. So, I think what lots of people don't seem to consider is that there's some sort of a doubling effect going on. So, like, the main character of the movie is a photographer who is like a dispassionate witness. He doesn't see, there isn't a personal stake for him in what he's photographing. like even when he tries to do serious artistic photography, those are just different kinds of models. Like he has his female models for one set, and he has his proletariat models for a different set, but his own emotional life is perfectly alike with both of those. He's similarly unmoved by the activity both times. So, you know, the main character is the photographer who only sees objects. Now, I'm suggesting that the doubling thing that's going on is that the film is as if made by a photographer who is seeing everything as objects. So that I'm suggesting that when David Hemmings is, when David Hemmings is there photographing the models, you know, what we really should be looking is that, there's David Hemmings looking at the models, but then there's also Michelangelo Antonioni looking at David Hemmings looking at the models. So that it's the film almost echoing its own sensibility. With that, but I mean, I think I think how this film gets misunderstood is I think how this film gets misunderstood is because if we think of that kind of doubling effect, that there's David Hemmings, he's being emotionally detached, and then there's Michelangelo Antonioni, the film director, he is superficially equally emotionally detached as David Hemmings. If we think of that kind of doubling effect, and we think that those two are like mirrors, I think that's when the plot, I think that's when the point of the movie starts getting lost on viewers. So what I'd argue is the real blow up of the movie, the real point of the movie, is that I think Michelangelo Antonioni is essentially calling out artists who are merely, posers. So that when you look at how David Hemmings, how he's just sort of phoning it in when he's doing his artistic serious photography, he has a set amount of talent, but he has a set amount of talent, but it's not really galvanized by a sense of purpose. And what I'm saying is that the reason why this film is misunderstood is because some people think that Michelangelo Antonioni is as vacant as the David Hemmings character in his filmmaking, and that's certainly not the case. Michelangelo Antonioni is galvanized by a sense of purpose, and that sense of purpose, what differentiates Antonioni from those who, you know, do, you know, artistic serious photography of workers leaving the factory, that kind of completely vacant serious content. What differentiates Antonioni from them is that Antonioni is always galvanized by a sense of purpose. And what I'm arguing is the sense of purpose in the movie is that when you look at the final scene in the movie, that's the most important scene in the film, and that's the scene is the most misunderstood. Or, well, it's not necessarily misunderstood, it's just plain not understood. Like, it's not as if people have, you know, necessarily myriad of theories about it. They just are baffled as to what's happening. So, the last scene of the film is that David Hemmings returns to the park of the missing corpse. And what he sees there, when he's completely dazed and confused as to, you know, how his life has been turned upside down by him, you know, having these brush-ups with Vanessa Redgrave. He's there completely dazed and confused, and what he sees is a bunch of mimes playing an imaginary tennis match. So that there's a bunch of there's two mimes and then like a like-minded audience, and you see that the mimes play this imaginary tennis match. They, you know, very convincingly go through the motions. Which, you know, some might see that something like that could be like, you know, let's say a parody of the kind of, you know, steady existence that the David Hemmings character was leading initially. But I don't think there's anything of that sort at all about it. I think the real point of the mime scene is that you look at, I think what the real subtext of the whole film is the collective nature inherent in a perception of truth. So what's happening is that like the mimes are playing an imaginary tennis match. There's a moment where like one of the mimes sort of misses the shot and the ball seems to roll to the feet of David Hemmings, and the whole entourage of mimes, they turn towards David Hemmings and they're like expecting him to throw the ball that rolled to his feet. So David Hemmings he sort of mimes picking up the imaginary ball and he throws it there, and then the mime tennis continues and they're glad that he's participating. But anyway, I think what Antonin is suggesting is that even though the tennis that the mimes are playing, it doesn't have any obvious reality. Like the tennis that they play, it shouldn't exist, but it is existing because there's a collective recognition of its existence. Because there's a society who's coming together and recognizing that the unexisting mime tennis is existing because of the collective nature of the agreement. It is lent an existence. And then that is contrasted with David Hemming's discovering the dead body. And what's happening is that even though the mime then the mime tennis doesn't have a physical reality, so it's absurd to think of it as existing. But because of the collectively agreed upon existence, it's seen as something real. But the dead body, it does have a physical existence. David Hemmings, like, we see what David Hemmings is seeing. There is a dead body there, but the crucial thing is that David Hemmings is the only one who sees it. There is no collective agreement about the dead body. So the dead body is denied the status of being truly there because it doesn't have a collective agreement. Like, a collective isn't like ratifying the David Hemmings assessment. So we see that something that should have a physical reality is denied its status as being truly there because of the absence of the collective agreement. And then with the mind, then is something that out of, like, if we rely on the laws of physics alone, that mime tennis shouldn't exist, but it is given an existence as something that's truly there. So, like, Antonin is contrasting those two things. But anyway, like, I think what the ultimate point of his movies is that it's made about the London of the swinging 60s. And if you remember me talking about Antonioni being a kind of double for the dispassionate photographer, Antonioni is dispassionately photographing his objects of the people who make up the London of the swinging 60s, the people who make up the scene. And the real blow up of the movie is Antonioni zeroing in on the things that contribute to making that swinging 60s scene. And Antonioni is zeroing in on them and then blowing them up and focusing on them. And one of the things is that, you know, in the 60s, people were like talking about, you know, things like free love. So anyway, like, the people who talked about free love, they weren't dispassionate about it. They were very much, passionate about the thing, and they had sort of a vested interest in that. They were passionate about their own opinions and their own preferences. And what's happening in Blow Up is that, the people who are the people who were passionate about the free love of the 60s, they felt all of those comments were made by subjects. But Antonioni is doing to those free love advocates what David Hemmings is doing to his models. He's making them be nothing but objects. And, I think Antonioni is basically suggesting that what the people of the swinging 60s London, what they claim to believe, I think Antonioni is sort of equating that with the mime tennis. In that he's saying that what the swinging 60s, what the people believed in, that it only has, it only makes sameness in their own minds because they're all agreeing with each other, you know? Just like that mind tennis, it only makes sense because everyone there is agreeing that it makes sense. But from an outsider, it would seem completely absurd. Like, only look at how the David Hemmings character is treating women throughout the films. He has the most sociopathic indifference. I mean, he doesn't even really seem to recognize that there's any humanity to them. You could say that he also doesn't seem to feel any, you know, much repulsing humanity in himself. But, you know, that's beside the point. The point is that anyone who takes a dispassionate look, the way that Antonioni is taking a dispassionate look at whatever's happening, you know, anyone who takes a dispassionate look at how David Hemmings treats women will have to acknowledge that he is just being an exploitative jerk, you know? He hasn't become disillusioned about monogamy or something like that. He hasn't ascended to a higher plane of consciousness where, you know, post-enlightenment, he is now living life as it should be led, you know. He's just a selfish jerk, you know. Like, you can, if you'd let him tell his own story, he could put some sort of a spin to it that, oh, you know, it's free love, you know, no strings attached, whatever. But, like, Antonioni is just sort of doing that blow-up of the kind of free love mentality and saying that, you know, you can say whatever you want about it, but I'm just gonna photograph it the way it seems to me. And the way it seems is that despite all of you being into your mind tennis about what free love you're doing, you're just selfish assholes in that kind of meaningless life where you're some sort of space cadets with your philosophies in the... I think that's ultimately, you know, the secret story in the blow-up, where, you know, it's very much a film where nothing is as it seems. Just like the Vanessa Redgrave character, she's never what she seems like. We don't know that she killed anyone. Like, you know, she's linked with a dude who died. Or is she? She's linked to a place where somebody died, maybe. She seems to act a bit shady about stealing some photographs, but, like, we're always denied any, like, you know, we are denied the reality of what Vanessa Redgrave is. We only get, like, we only have random theories about what we think she might be about. And I think Antonioni is giving her that kind of shifting identity. Because I think what Antonioni is suggesting that if we don't put that kind of mime tennis layer over reality, if we don't just, like, give an official story in that, oh, our generation is about free love and so on, if we don't put that kind of official story that's just sort of dumbing down existence, like, and if we just take things as they are, then things as they are will be like that Vanessa Redgrave character, in that we're constantly thrown out of what we thought happened. Like, we're constantly put into being, not necessarily in the wrong, but certainly put out of being in the right about her. We definitely cannot claim to know her. And I think Antonioni's final, like, his ultimate point in the movie is just I think what he's doing is that if the David Hemmings character is like turning everything he sees into an object, I think what Antonin is suggesting is that when we think that we definitely know something because we give it an official story, I think Antonioni, I think there's yet a further doubling in that Antonioni is suggesting that we as audience are something like the David Hemmings character, that we are like photographers who turn something into an object, and then we, as if we recontextualize it as something that we know. And, you know, Antonioni is just calling out behavior like that as something that's on the level of the mime tennis, in that the only thing that prevents it from being crazy is because like people with vested interests are sort of self-evaluating their collective behavior as being perfectly sane, perfectly normal, and perfectly productive. You know, Antonioni is just, he's looking at the society and he's noticing how the society isn't really understanding itself. And he's just sort of photographing their confusion about themselves. And, you know, I've seen so many critics sort of completely miss the point of this movie and think that Antonioni is being sort of some sort of a leading modernist in here. And, you know, if you think of everything I said about the film, does it really sound like Antonioni is being some sort of a cheerleader for the modern ethos that he's photographing? You know, I think that the real point of Blow Up is Antonioni just highlighting how many people will miss the point in the movie because they are ultimately too much like the David Hemmings character, and that they are sort of incapable of getting anything beyond the kind of really superficial differentiation into, oh, you know, fashion photography of this it girl models, well, that's shallow, but then artistic photography of workers leaving the factory, well, that's serious. Like, Antonioni is sort of equating the audience with the David Hemmings character, and, you know, he's just on a plot level, the film is all about David Hemmings seeing others and picturing them, but then on a more subtextual level, it's Antonioni flipping things upside down, in that David Hemmings isn't the one who's seeing, but the one who is seen. He isn't the one who's picturing, but the one who is being pictured. And to me, it seems like he's as if, like, secretly pushing the David Hemmings character against the wall and saying that, look, at the kind of life you're leading, you know, just look at it. There's nothing in that life that is somehow less vacant than the fashion photography that he's taking. Like, all of his moments have that kind of tonality to it because of him being that kind of, you know, vacant observer who is incapable of sort of having the kind of open-minded, lively intelligence towards reality that he would need to be able to deal with somebody like the Vanessa Redgrave character. But, you know, he isn't up for the task. And the film is existing, to me it seems like, for Antonioni to call out, you know, in the 1960s there was this kind of new wave or avant-garde brand of younger intellectuals who claimed to be some sort of, you know, advanced observers of our society. And I really think that Blow Up is Antonioni basically calling those people out and saying that, you know, look, it's cute that you're trying to be some sort of a genius, but really you guys sort of just seem to me like that idiot photographer there. So, you know, that was my take on the ultimate point of Blow Up. And if I just to sum up, talk a bit more about my overall views on the film, I think it's one of the better Antonioni films, but I don't think it's necessarily him at his absolute best. But, you know, I'd say that it's a very good film, which I think has a lot more to it than what some people are recognizing. But anyway, that was just some of my thoughts about it, and thank you for watching. I'll try to do a couple of more, you know, discussions on some more interesting classics of arthouse cinema, but I don't yet know which I should do next. But anyway, that was all for me. Hopefully I will see you at some of my other videos as well. But anyway, thanks for watching.